Welcome back to what is likely to be the longest session of Soul Blazer. Not that that means anything to you guys, because, I mean, these videos always get chopped up into 15-20-minute chunks anyway. But here we are in Soul Blazer, and right away we see another soul that King Magrid didn't get. Apparently the doors here are sentient and have souls. So that's nice to know. Here we are in Dr. Leo's desert bungalow, and we can't really go anywhere because the house is in a sorry state. It's in a very decrepit state of disrepair. Fortunately, Dr. Leo has what I can only describe as an aperture science level of horrifying laboratory space down underneath his house. It is ridiculous how much, like, what is the purpose of all this machinery and all this equipment? Like, what did he accomplish from having all this? I have no idea, but he does. He built all of it. You would think that a man who did this much work and built this much piping and sewage lines and I can only assume electrical equipment, whatever end he had in mind, when King Magrid came and says, "Hey man, I have to put you in a small room, and you have to build me a cell phone so I can call the King of Evil," why didn't Dr. Leo just say no? I know, something something, he was gonna hurt Lisa, but just, like, put Lisa in a safe place in your giant mechanical fortress patrolled by robots. We got 15 monster layers on this screen. That's quite a lot. Oh, I can't kill these ones. We are going to, very quickly, in this area, we are going to have to leave this area, because we will have found... Oh, we can't kill them either. The steam cleaners we can kill. The little, what is that, like a little robotic chicken? I'm not even sure what that thing is, but we can't kill it in any event. And it's just gonna... It's just gonna run around, basically, while we get steam cleaned repeatedly. I've always been very partial to this music, even though it's kind of objectively terrible. Like, it's kind of not... I mean, you're hearing it, it's not fantastic. It doesn't exactly make the ears pop and sizzle, does it? But, I don't know, I've always had a fondness for it. It's just so bizarre. It doesn't sound quite like anything else in the game, which is good, because this whole area doesn't... it's very alien compared to the rest of the game, and this is already a game that has lots of alien areas in it, but... I think there is a kind of tendency to... Oh, actually, I think we might be completely boned here. Yeah, Helicopter Man's gonna chase us around. I wanna see if I can open up this last layer before we have to go back, but I think my sword is ready. 12 more monster layers, and yeah, I think we need to go back now. See if you can follow along my line of thought here. The fantasy series, kind of in general, tend to start out a lot more fantastical, and then the more and more that they go on... Is there a path up there? There's not. I'm just getting bulldozed if I go that way. The more and more they go on, they kind of settle into their own nature, if that makes sense. I'll give some examples. Like, if you've read the first couple of books in the Discworld series, The Color of Magic and the Light Fantastic, and at the time that those books came out, the series hadn't quite gelled yet. Is this the Zantetsu sword? It sure is, which means we are leaving. We're getting out of here. We can defeat metal monsters now. Beautiful! So we gotta go back and kill a whole bunch of metal monsters. If you read the book, like, there's a lot of wacky stuff in there that doesn't really gel with the rest of Discworld. Like, at one point, they go through, like, a dimensional portal, I guess? And they kind of end up on an airplane. It gets really, really bizarre. But later on, the Discworld books fall into their own kind of retinue of surreal. That is very unmistakably Discworld. Another good example might be something like the... this is not the right place. There's no metal monsters in the underground castle. In the purview of video games, a good example might be the Ultima games. If you Probably you get, have never played Ultima 1 or Ultima 3. Probably. Yeah, we got one monster lair in like each area of the painting world here. I think we're gonna get some new armor. Putting all this together. Ultima 1, like, you had to get into a spaceship. Like, these are fantasy games. The people, if you're familiar with the Ultima games, typically you're familiar with them as their sword and sorcery games. Let's pay attention to who we're getting. Yes, that Ivy, we're going to climb up and get some fun stuff, because we can go through the children's clubhouse. It's a sword and sorcery series, but, like, Ultima 1, you have to get into a spaceship and go into outer space, and you've got to kill a bunch of, like, you have to become a space ace, and then the princess will give you the whatever. And Ultima 2 is, like, you're time traveling through all the different planets in the solar system. Like, there are maps. You can go to Pluto and Jupiter, and it kind of gets the sense of they're just kind of playing with the setting at first. Nothing is actually in place. And obviously that's not the stuff that's stuck when it comes to Ultima games. The series kind of gelled after Ultima 4. They put together the whole system of virtues, and I don't know where this spider is even going. He's coming around. He's coming around. We'll get him coming up this way. Ah, I love that beautiful sound. And so I kind of feel like that about Soul Blazer a little bit, too, because you've got this giant, like, mechanical dungeon. The sequel to the game, Illusion of Gaia, is steeped very much in actual, like, geographical location. That Ivy is going to be important, too. I think there's an emblem up there, perhaps. We do need to do this, actually. I think there's... in St. El's, I think there's one metal monster dungeon that we actually have to unlock to finish the game. Hey, let's try out this terrible magic that we got. Tornado! That's not my magic button. There it is. Yeah, good. I can't control where it goes. It's just gonna do its own thing. Yeah, we're gonna go ahead and put that back on magic missile there. Illusion of Gaia never leaves that kind of geographical historical setting. And then Terranigma has, from what I know about it, I'm very actually ignorant of what's in Terranigma because I haven't completed it, but my understanding is you can go to like Neo Tokyo and there are kind of mechanical dungeons and things, but they're much more in setting because the setting itself takes place over like a long timeline. Soul Blazer, Dr. Leo's lab just feels very out of place. It feels very anachronistic. It feels like booting up an Ultima game and then having to go become a space ace. Ooh, a new sword, actually. It's, I need to be level 22 to use it. And it fills up my hit points, so that's good. So I can't actually swing that sword, but I can still hold it out in front of me and do the stabby stabby crab walk. If I were so inclined. I thought that I got armor there, but I guess not. It's probably still better to use... Ah, Emblem A. It's probably still better to use the, the Zantetsu sword for the swinginess of it. So now Grass Valley is well and truly done. There are no more monster lairs. The entire city is completely restored to its original glory. Where are we going here? We need to go to the Fire Shrine. So I think it's going to be this... Yeah, this will get us right to the Fire Shrine. I think there's scorpions to kill on all three floors of the Fire Shrine. And then there's ghosts in the Light Shrine that we have to come back for much later. I was watching some Soul Blazer randomizer, which I've mentioned in previous videos. I haven't actually played it for myself yet. Soul Blazer's not a game that I really feel comfortable randomizing because I don't know the game as well as I do some of the other randomizers that I play. But I was watching, I think, a tournament. People were playing tournaments. I guess I got all the scorpions. I didn't really hear the monster lair explode, but... And if you get an early Zantetsu sword in that randomizer, it's really cool because you can just go into the dungeons here. No, I'm gonna stay. I don't know why it just puts a return point. In a monster lair, you have to wait halfway through the game to clear. Anyway. Yeah, you get an early Zantetsu sword, and... basically, it's an experience farm, because you're not supposed to be able to kill these scorpions and stuff. Oh, I think we're gonna put on ice armor here. That's bubble armor. So I don't have to worry about these hot bridges. Yeah, see, these hot floors I can walk on just fine. Not so much the volcanically hot floors. Although, looking at just the sheer amount of lava, you wouldn't think that, like, that little bit of just igneous rock on Durian Island would have bothered us. If the ice armor can withstand this heat, surely it can withstand just a little bit of igneous rock. Alright, how many scorpions? One more? Six more? There should be one more around here somewhere. I wonder if we've just done laps. Ah, here we go. Oh, there's a whole bunch more, never mind. There's that glorious sound. I don't even know how I feel about that, though, because... I guess it really depends on the setting. We have to pay attention to who we're releasing here so I can make sure I know what I'm doing. Because one of these NPCs is going to have a very important item that we need later. Sometimes in a fantasy setting, I think I'm okay with... like, the very weird abstract stuff. The stuff that's obviously just the writers playing around. On the other hand... I really, really do appreciate a well-crafted fantasy world, like one that I feel like I can inhabit and get lost in. Like, I've read a bunch of the Discworld books now, and by far my least favorite ones were those first two that I read. Because nothing takes me out of the story as much as, oh, they're on an airplane now for some reason. Okay, it's... sure, I guess. I'm much more willing to buy into... the surreal nature of a fantasy setting if it's kind of baked into the setting. If it just feels like an author kind of playing around and not editing out ideas that might not fit. But then again, I mean, these stories, as thing is, especially in the case of the first two Ultima games, and I have to wander out looking for this last scorpion. I don't know where he is. I don't have a scorpion radar. You don't get that until World 9. Like, I think especially in the case of the first two Ultima games, like, the book hadn't really been written yet on what is, like, what goes into a computer RPG. Like, Ultima was one of the first, so... really? I gotta walk all the way around again? Fine, I'll do it. No more monster layers here, though. Oh, that definitely wasn't worth doing. I gotta get that hundo, though. You know what I mean? Alright, so we have 0, 0, and 0. So I wonder if, like, Richard Garriott, who wrote the first couple of Ultima games, and he might have written all of them, I'm not sure. I know he was the creator of this series and is the primary creative force behind almost everything in the Ultima universe, but I know as the series progressed, more and more people obviously had their hands... in the pie, so to speak, but originally it was just Richard Garriott for the first, I don't know, maybe 5 or 6 games even. I released this bird here. He's gonna tell me I need 3 symbols. So I think there's another bird I have to release in this area with a ghost sword where I can actually get the red hot items. Alright, one more stop. We need to go back to Durian Island. So... that goes to Southerta. I think we just need to go this way. I don't think there's like an easy way to get directly to Durian Island. But looking at it from, say, Richard Garriott's point of view... like, he wasn't... when he was setting out, the sword and sorcery genre was still kind of... in its infancy, like, yeah, Lord of the Rings and stuff existed, but I think the original Ultima games were just more like, everything that I'm interested in is going to go in this game. Like, I have a particular set of interests, and I'm going to mix them all together. It's fiction anyway, it's fantasy no matter how you look at it. I don't remember which island is Durian, I'll be honest. I do not even know. I'm going to guess maybe this way, because I think Durian is the last of the islands you go to, and this is the second area of the seabed. In fact, the only time I've seen Richard Garriott live was at a panel in Dragon Con, and it wasn't even about his fantasy writings, it was about space exploration. He being a major contributor to, I think, SpaceX, and is very interested in progressing that sort of technology. Is this Durian? No, this is Blester. So yeah, I looked at it in that light, those early Ultima games, like, hey, you know what, I like Swords and Sorcery, I like space exploration, there's no reason we can't have both. Even though his, you know what, that didn't go well. I got off when I shouldn't have gotten off. I got off at the wrong spot. Ooh, she'll send me back. Yes, please. Alright, misspelled. There are a lot of fantasy settings that actually do that combination more expertly. Like, the original Final Fantasy was mostly swords and sorcery, but it had one area of the game that had robots and robotic sentries and a war mech and whatnot. But it didn't bleed over very much. Like, it was very clearly meant to be a very alien part of the world. If you go over to the Sega side of things, the Phantasy Star games do kind of the same thing. Oh, is it that cave there, maybe? Eventually we're going to find Durian. We just don't have a very... We don't have a warp point there. The warp point goes either to Southerta or to the final boss of the area, which is not helpful to me. Oh my goodness. Shout out to Bob for sponsoring this video. If you liked the video and you want to see more, please tickle my thumb, leave a friendly comment, and ring my little bell.